Amen. Let's stand. We'll sing page number 160. Are you washed in the blood? Page 160 on the second verse. Turn around and shake someone's hand this morning.
You better come sing another verse. There's still people talking and dilly-daddling. We're going to sing one more verse as you make your way back to your seats, all right?
Second verse. Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood?
You may be seated. If you're still shaking hands, there is a $100 fine for not being back in your seat by the time we're done. Not really. Gentlemen, come on with those offering plates. We'll go ahead and get our offering in just a minute. I've got several announcements I need to make. Somebody found a set of keys in a pew. I don't know whose these are. Anybody missing a set of keys or a set of peas? What's that? Whose are they? All right, well, if they're still here at the end of the day, whatever car they fit goes home with me. So that's how that's going to work. If you're missing your keys, they're up here. I'm assuming you'll know before you leave that you're missing them. We need to write down a date. It's not. We haven't pushed it and advertised a whole lot just yet, but you go ahead and write that date down if you want. It's going to be May 29th and 30th. That is this year's couples retreat. And if you want to go to that, there'll be more information out in the foyer next week with more details about the times and all of that. We want to make sure that you're aware of it now. That's May 29th and 30th. And we want you to be a part of that if you can. We have lots of rooms reserved, but we need to get a good solid count on how many are actually planning on going so we make sure that we have enough rooms and we can release whatever rooms we don't need. This year's speaker is going to be Doug Rogers. His wife, Jana, is going to try to come with him. He's one of our missionaries that we support in Mexico, and he'll be a blessing to you, I promise. How many of you have never heard Doug Rogers speak before? A lot of you. Oh, you've got a plan on coming. I'm telling you, it'll be a help to you and your marriage. And so that'll be on May 29th and 30th. And we're going to be going to the same place we went to last time. And the name of it slips my mind right now. What's it called? The Shack. It's a couples retreat, so it's called the Love Shack. Speaking of love. We had our couples banquet last night here at church. All right, if you came to it, then you already know this. I mentioned part of this morning in the 10 o'clock hour. I had this game called Stuck on You. All right, the game was the couples came up. I think there was six couples, whatever. They stood across a table facing each other with a bowl of gummy bears between them. And they had 30 seconds to see how many gummy bears the wife could lick and stick to her husband's face. All right. You could, and some of them were biting the heads off because they stick better that way. Which, by the way, Brother Dowdy managed to have 13 gummy bears stuck to his face. And him and Miss, let me tell you how they, I'm not even sure, we should have just disqualified you guys. I was pretty clear with the instructions. I looked over, Brother Dowdy is standing there, head tilt back, eyes closed, tongue sticking out. His wife is two gummy bears at a time, running them down his tongue and sticking them, running them down. It's like, it didn't say, it had to be your own tongue is the rule. So anyway, under protest, we had to redo that, and they still end up winning. But anyway, and then someone said it's because he has more real estate up here to stick things to. Anyway, we had a good time. But anyway, afterwards, we were cleaning up. I had to take all the props from the games, everything to the kitchen. We're going to clean up later. I walked into the kitchen, and all the TFM students, the guys were standing around, mowing down on gummy bears. Yeah, you know where they came from? The leftovers from the game, you know what the leftovers were? All the gummy bears that had been stuck to people's head, they were back in the bowls, and the boys were mowing down on those things. Absolutely repulsive is what that was. Anyway, the Love Shack. Be there. May 29th and 30th is how we got to this point in the service. Missions conference coming up. It's just about a week and a half away. It's just a few days away from now. Please mark your calendars. It's going to be February 26th, which is the last Wednesday in February, all the way through the first Sunday in March. In those few days there, please mark your calendars. Be here if at all possible. Even if you had to cancel something to be here, I promise you, you won't regret it. I want you to be here to kind of get an update on what we did in missions last year. And we've got a big project coming up this year that we need all the participation that we can possibly get. So please be here for our missions conference on those days, if you would, please. And then next Sunday is the last Sunday to give towards faith missions giving for the 2019 year. And so you have this Sunday and next Sunday. Let's finish strong. And if you've made commitments, let's try to just be as faithful as we can to those commitments. Next Sunday will be the last time that you're able to give towards last year's faith missions giving. And then the following Sunday starts the 2020 year for that giving. So plan on finishing out strong for the year, if you would, please. And then we're going to start something this coming Tuesday morning. It's going to go every Tuesday morning to the end of March. We're going to be meeting at 7 o'clock on Tuesday mornings. For anyone that wants to join us, we'll have some coffee and donuts available. Some of you will be on your way to work, passing by. Some of you don't work, so you could be here anyway. But at 7 o'clock, we're going to meet on Tuesday mornings for prayer, leading up to our missions conference and then extending past our missions conference. And I hope you'll plan on being here for that. Obviously, there's you can't be at everything. I get that. But some of you are available that time of day, maybe even passing through. You want to stop by for some fellowship and some prayer. I'd love to pray with you for a little while. So it'll be Tuesday mornings at 7 a.m. here at the church. All right, let me know if you have questions about that. And then on the 25th, which is the Tuesday night before missions conference starts, there'll be a cottage prayer meeting at mine and Melody's house. That's be running from 7 to 9 p.m. All right, so cottage prayer meeting at our house, 7 to 9 on the 25th. We'll have a sign-up sheet out in the foyer next Sunday so we know how many people we can plan on running out of the house at 9 o'clock to get rid of. All right. I think that's all of the announcements at this time. No, that's not all of the announcements. The Thoroughly Furnished Kids, let me tell you, that the banquet last night was a fundraising banquet for the TFM students. They're going on a missions trip to Cuba this summer. And just over $1,000 was raised through that banquet last night. So thank you for your generosity to those kids. They are excited. They're very excited. I was going to have one of them come up here and thank you in person, but they're all working this morning at different places in the building. And so I'm telling you thank you on their behalf. That makes about $5,061 to be exact, has come in for that mission trip, and that greatly reduces the cost on these kids. It would have been over $1,000 for them to go on the trip, plus passport costs and all of that. But because of your generosity, that's greatly reduced the cost. And they have some more fundraisers coming up. They're trying to get as much money covered as they can. There is a pop can drive starting this morning. If you have them in your car, just bring them in. But if you want to bring bags of them, don't bring them in the foyer, please. Don't bring them in. Put them by the back door downstairs next week when you come. And just moving forward, where the can drive will be going on. For the next few weeks anyway. So if you have cans laying around the house and you don't want to, this is a perfect opportunity, it's a perfect excuse not to go return your cans. Just bring them, dump them at church, let the kids take care of it, all right? And all of those proceeds will go to the TFM mission trip as well, all right? Who's got the microphone this morning? Brother Jenkins, how about asking a blessing on the offering, please, sir?
Heavenly Father, we thank you again for the opportunity to be in your house this morning, Lord. We just pray now for this offering, Lord, that we pray that it would meet the needs of our church, Lord. We just thank you for the many opportunities that we have to give, Lord, and we just pray, Lord, for the gift today, Lord, that it would go to a great cause and would be able to continue to further your work, Lord. We love you for all you've done for us, Lord. We just bless the gift and the giver. We ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Dowdy's going to sing in just a moment. As he's getting ready to sing, let me tell you something encouraging to me. Most of you know what Thoroughly Furnished Ministries is. Some of you don't. It's just a youth Bible training program that we've been running at our church for almost exactly a year now. It's a 3-year Bible course, and it gets our kids involved in several areas of ministry. Well, in the last 4 weeks, 3 of the TFM students have taught our kids classes for us, and that was the first time teaching for some of them, and they're doing an absolutely fantastic job. And then last night at the banquet, many of you made comments about how good the kids are at this church, the young people, and just the attitudes they have, and I want to commend the parents. It's wonderful, wonderful to be able to serve the Lord in a church where the teenagers are eager and just want to get involved. I think it speaks very, very highly of the young people, but also the families in the church. So I just want to let you know those things. Brother Dowdy.
the timeless theme. Earth and heaven will pass away. It's not a dream. God will make all things new that day. Gone is the curse from which I stumbled and fell. Evil is banished to eternal hell. No more night, no more pain, no more tears, never crying again. Praises to is the praises to Christ our King. Slowly the names from the book are read. I know the King, and there's no need to
for the music. Thank you, musicians. We're finished this morning. Thank you for your help up here. Go ahead and take your Bibles out and please find the book of 2 Kings, the book of 2 Kings, chapter 22, book of 2 Kings 22. I didn't sing in the choir this morning. I got to stand in the back and listen to them sing, and I have so enjoyed every bit of the music this morning. It's been beautiful to me. Thank you for all the hard work that goes into the music in this church. We're blessed to have talent and ability, but those things won't get you very far if you're not willing to use it. It's the truth. So thank you for being willing to use your abilities of the music in this church. I don't know if you noticed or not, but we do still have some empty seats in choir, and some of you ought to be up there singing with them. And so if you'd like to get to be a part of choir, then talk to Brother Dowdy. He'll give you all the information you need to know about that. I enjoy it. I really do. I enjoy all things music. But I've enjoyed the music this morning especially. 2 Kings chapter 22, if you found that, say amen. Amen. Why don't you stand with me? We'll read a couple of verses together, give you one more chance to stretch your legs, and then we'll get right into the message this morning. Everybody standing and looking at 2 Kings chapter 22. I'd like to read verse 5. If you would find 2 Kings 22, verse 5, it says, "And let them deliver it into the hand of the doers of the work that have the oversight of the house of the Lord, and let them give it to the doers of the work which is in the house of the Lord to repair the breaches of the house." Lord, please help us this morning. God, would you help me be able to speak clearly, and Lord, help my thoughts be concise this morning. Be glorified by all that we do and we say. Please speak to our hearts in some way. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. In this passage of Scripture, in this 22nd and 23rd chapter of 2 Kings, we find something absolutely amazing taking place. Really, in chapter 23 is where we see the actual event that I'm speaking about. We find that the nation of Judah has had some bad kings, but unlike the nation of Israel, the northern kingdom, they've also had a few good kings mixed in there. Not perfect kings, not really all of them tremendous kings, but some have not been totally bad. But because of the depravity and the rebellion in the nation of Judah, we find that the people are so backslidden and cold towards the Lord. There's idolatry running rampant. There's immorality running rampant. But we get to chapter 23, and there's what might be the greatest revival that has ever taken place. It's recorded in this chapter. We're going to kind of tell the story backwards because we need to get to the beginning of the story this morning. But it's a little bit different, I understand. But let's start at the revival and let's try to discover together the cause of the revival. And maybe not even necessarily the cause, but the enabling. Things that had to happen in order for this revival to take place. Now, let's start reading in chapter 23. Look at verse 5. I want you to notice this revival when people begin to get right with God, they begin to tear down these idols. Look at verse 5. It says, "And he put down the idolatrous priests whom the kings of Judah had ordained to burn incense in the high places in the cities of Judah, and in the places round about Jerusalem, them also that burned incense unto Baal, to the sun, and to the moon, and to the planets, and to all the host of heaven." Verse 6. "And he brought out the grove from the house of the Lord." You notice where he brought it out of? From the house of the Lord. He's bringing out these idols, these altars. He's bringing these things out from the temple of God. These people had reached such a place that they are involved in idolatry inside the temple of God. It gets worse. Look what it says in the rest of the verse. It says, "Unto the brook Kidron, and burned it at the brook Kidron, and stamped it small to powder, and cast the powder thereof upon the graves of the children of the people. And he brake down the houses of the Sodomites that were by the house of the Lord, where the women wove hangings and for the grove." We're talking about immorality just outside the door of the house of God. These people were so backslidden, but we're reading about a revival taking place. People getting right with God. Look at verse 8. "And he brought all the priests out of the cities of Judah and defiled the high places where the priests had burned incense from Geba to Beersheba and break down the high places of the gates that were in the entering in of the gate of Joshua, the governor of the city, which were on a man's left hand at the gate of the city. Nevertheless, the priests of the high places came not to the up to the altar of the Lord in Jerusalem, but they did eat of the unleavened bread among their brethren, and he defiled Topheth, which is in the valley of the children of Hinnom, that no man might make his son or his daughter to pass through the fire to Molech." Do you catch what we're reading? These people are repenting of their sin, and as they begin to try to confess and get right with God, they look around and they see all the idols around them, people burning incense to false gods and sacrificing to Baal. Beyond that, they look at the temple and they say, it's not just they're doing it in other places, they're doing it even here at the temple of our God. And they're burning incense and they're worshiping these false idols. And it's worse than that. As the Bible says, the Sodomites were just outside the door of the house where the women were weaving hangings. It's referring to, most people believe it's referring to immorality and prostitution at the house of God. This is mind-blowing. And it would be sad enough if we were just reading about what's taking place, but it's not sad at this point because the people are fixing it. They're getting right. And the last thing that he fixes is he tears down the idols, gets rid of the priests so that no one would burn their children in the fire anymore. They were offering their children to Moloch, but not anymore, because there's a revival breaking out. What an amazing thing taking place in this wicked nation. Revival breaking out. Well, why did the revival break out? Let's go back a little bit further into the story. We see the end result was revival, a sweeping revival, a reforming revival. Well, how did this happen? Well, look what it says in chapter 23, verse 2. We find the answer. We find that the king got right. Look what it says. And the king went up into the house of the Lord, and all the men of Judah and all the inhabitants of Jerusalem with him, and the priests and the prophets and all the people, both small and great. And he read in their ears all the words of the book of the covenant, which was found in the house of the Lord. You know what got the revival started? It was the book being read in the ears of the people. All those people who were just immersed and saturated with idolatry. The king says, if we're going to fix this thing, if we're going to get right, we've got to have the book. They got up and began to read the book in the ears of the people. Well, what happened? Well, the people said, we can't have this. Look what the book says. It says idolatry is wrong. It says not to make any graven images. We've got to fix this. So the book was read, and revival swept through the land. So let's go back even a little bit further now. The end result was revival. What brought the revival? Well, the reading of the book. Well, what brought the reading of the book? It's one man repenting and getting right. Go back, if you would, please, just a few more verses back into chapter 22. Chapter 22, let's look at what this says in verse, let's start reading in verse 10. And Shaphan the scribe showed the king, saying, Hilkiah the priest hath delivered me a book. And Shaphan read it before the king. And it came to pass, when the king had heard the words of the book of the law, that he rent his clothes. Did you catch this? A massive revival, nationwide revival. How did it happen? Someone read a book. What prompted the reading of the book in the ears of the people? One man getting right with God. One man, someone gave one man a book. Said, we think you might want to read this. The king read it, and he was so disturbed by what he read in the book. The Bible says he rent his clothes and wept. You see, there's this progression. So what caused the king to read the book? Well, now we're getting to where we want to be. Back up with me, if you would, please, to verse 6. Verse 8, rather. It says in Hilkiah, the high priest said unto Shaphan, the scribe, I have found the book of the law in the house of the Lord. And Hilkiah gave the book to Shaphan, and he read it. Nationwide revival brought on by the public reading of the Word of God, which was brought on by the king repenting because he read the book, which was brought on by, are you ready? Somebody going and finding the book. It all started back when the scribe and the priest were in the house of God cleaning it out, and they came across the book. It had been decades since the house of God had been used to worship God. Decades since that book had been read. It wasn't stolen. It wasn't destroyed. It was right in their midst the whole time. It just was neglected. A sweeping revival because somebody began to clean the house of God. But now let's answer the very last question. How did the house of God come to be cleaned out? And this is the message for this morning. Listen, we've progressed all the way through these steps to where the end result was a national revival. Here's what brought it on. Look what it says, please, in verse 3. And it came to pass in the 18th year of King Josiah that the king sent Shaphan, the son of Azaliah, the son of Meshullam, the scribe of the house of the Lord, saying, here's what he told him to go do. Go up to Hilkiah the high priest, that he may sum the silver which is brought into the house of the Lord, which the keepers of the door have gathered of the people, and let them deliver it into the hand of the doers of the work that have the oversight of the house of the Lord, and let them give it to the doers of the work which is in the house of the Lord to repair the breaches of the house. The king said, go tell the high priest, I want to repair and renovate the house of God. Tell him we want to get rid of all the idols. Tell him we want to get rid of the dust and the clutter. Open the doors for the first time in who knows how long. Go tell him to do this. And someone might have said, well, excuse me, sir, things cost money. How are we supposed to do this? I want you to notice what was the enabling of the entire process. He says there's a sum of money collected in a box, and it was collected by the people. It came from the people. The king says, take that money that the people gave and begin to repair the house of God. So if I could tell it to you this way, a sweeping national revival took place because someone somewhere contributed. I'm not overstating it, folks. Read your Bible. It says the people gave, and because they gave, there was a revival in the nation. Now, we don't have time this morning to go back there, but if you were to go back to chapters 12 and chapter 13, you would find that this isn't the first time that this has been attempted. There was another king who tried to do the same thing, and he actually tried to collect the money from the people. The people were bringing it, but there were priests who were running off with it, using it for whatever they wanted to be used for. So at one point, the high priest said, we can't have any of this. Let's get a box. The Bible says he bored a hole in top of the box, and people would come, and they would drop their money in. The box was fastened, and they were raising money for the renovation of the temple. But before they could get started, there was an invading army outside the gates, and they ended up having to take that money and use it to buy off their enemies. And so the house sat dormant and empty. But somewhere in those 60 to 70 some years, somebody kept giving. Somebody stayed faithful in their giving. Because when this young man named Josiah, 8 years old when he came to the throne, at some point Josiah said, we can't keep living the way we're living. We've got to get right with the Lord. We've got to get back to where we ought to be. And when he said, we've got to fix up the house of God, the money was there. Somebody had given something that would in turn be turned into a national reviving. Now, folks, listen, we're getting ready to come into our missions conference. Our missions conference is the time we set aside to focus on global missions. The only way this church can have a part in global missions is if somebody says, I'm going to be faithful in contributing. I can't do it all, but I can do some. Now listen to me. We will not see returns on our money, full returns on our money in our lifetime, more than likely. You and I will never meet some of the people that our missions money impacts in other countries. You will never meet them. We'll never look them in the eye. But I believe that the Word of God is still quick and powerful. I believe it's still sharper than any two-edged sword. I believe that it discerns. I believe it separates. I believe that it's the Word of God that this world needs. And if we will just enable the sending, if we'll enable some king somewhere to have the book, then who knows if some Eastern mystic could read a book one day and say, if this is the true God, and if worshiping idols is wrong, then we have offended the one true God. If you don't believe it could happen, I promise you it'll happen. History says it happens in jungle tribes, small villages here and there, The entrance of the gospel of Jesus Christ changes lives. But it'll only happen if someone somewhere says, I'll be faithful. I'll be faithful. I'll do my part. I don't know how heaven will be completely. I mean, we can use our imagination and we come up with some pretty fanciful ideas of what heaven's going to be like. I don't know how it'll be exactly. The Bible says that in some form or another, God is going to say to some people, well done, thou good and faithful servant. I want to be in that number. I'm not a wealthy man, but God has given us the ability to contribute. And I might not see the national revival, but wouldn't it be great if somewhere in the future someone's reading the story and they say, because a little church in Chelsea, Michigan contributed a little money, they got the Bible. Because they got the Bible, people were saved. Because people got saved, churches were started. Because churches were started, revival swept through. All because somebody gave. That's how it started in 2 Kings. That's how it started. I ask you, church, what are you willing to do to see it started again? What are we willing to do? And the Lord has blessed this church. Oh, He's blessed us. We just went over the financial report in the business meeting last week. Missions giving is an all-time high. Praise God for that. What a blessing. Come on. This little church, this is not a mega church. This is not, this is a little country Baptist church. Over $200,000 last year spent on missions. That's somebody somewhere being faithful, and they're contributing. If you think I'm bragging, I am bragging. I'm bragging on what God can do through His people. That's all this is. Someone somewhere has to contribute. I've been praying for the last several months that in our missions conference, God would burden my heart for where He's leading my family with our giving this year. I've asked you to do the same. The New Testament principle for giving is that every heart, every person gives as his heart purposes. I want my heart to desire to give. I want my heart to determine my giving. Not a loudmouth preacher screaming from the pulpit. I want my heart to be burdened for that which burdens my Savior's heart. And I'll tell you what burdens the Savior's heart. It's the lost souls that He gave His Son to save. If we just get His burden, then giving won't be an issue. You can close your Bibles. I think we'll be done. We're not concerned with building a physical house like they were in the Old Testament. The Bible says that we're built up a spiritual house. The Bible says we're the habitation of God through His Spirit. The Bible says that we are built up as lively stones, every member joined and fastened together. We're not so much concerned about renovating the physical house of God. What I am concerned about is building the house of God. How do we do that? Well, we get the gospel into one more hand, and one more hand, and one more hand. In June, we're going to be coming together to assemble 300,000 John and Romans. 300,000. Many of which will be sent into a closed communist country that I can't say because we're streaming. That's exciting to me. There's missionaries right now waiting on these things. They'll be smuggled in inside car doors, inside spare tires. They'll be, listen, it's the Word of God. It's got to be sent. It's got to be paid for. And that's what we do. That's what we do. Who knows what underground churches could be started because someone somewhere contributed. 12 cents per copy seems awfully cheap, doesn't it? I'm excited about the year. I'm excited. I hope you are. I hope you are. Let's stand together, please. National revival in the kingdom of Judah. Because the king said, we've got some work that needs to be done. And someone said, well, let's get to it because the people have already given. Someone somewhere gave some money. Let's get to it. I am of the belief that all that I own is God's. All that I am is in His hand. My marriage is in His hand. My family is in His hand. And if I can contribute just a little bit and God do something wonderful with it, then sign me up. Sign me up. Would you bow your heads, please, and close your eyes? If you're here this morning and you are a guest with us, then this may seem like a greedy preacher talking because the one time you come to church, I talk about money. But if you're a faithful part of Faith Baptist Church, then you know we don't talk about money very often at all. But I do think it's important to be reminded of what God can do if someone somewhere will contribute. Now, we have contributed this last year, and I have hope that you've prayed, that you are praying and asking God to help you and enable you to go to the next level, not for our glory, but for His. With heads bowed and eyes closed this morning, just by a show of hands, I wonder, would you say to me, the preacher this morning, I commit to you, I'm going to pray between now and missions conference, I'm going to pray about what God will have me and my family do for Him. Can I see your hands? God bless you. Thank you. You can put them down. I had in my notes some references we could have looked at in the Old Testament about what happens when people give willingly. That's amazing things. That's all God wants is willingness. Cheerful givers. That's what God wants. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Miss Laura began to play something on the piano over there. The altar's open this morning. It might be just a wonderful time to get to an altar and ask God, first of all, to give you wisdom as you pray and try to decide about your faith missions giving. But then also it might be a wonderful morning to give the altar and just say, God, would you enable me to do more? God, would you help me be a good steward with what you've given me? God, would you give me the wisdom to use it wisely? And then, Father, would you increase my ability to give? Might be a good morning for that. There's folks at the altar already. Maybe you ought to join them. Maybe you ought to join them. And then maybe you're here this morning, and even as we sat in this place hearing and reading about revival, it might just be that you're here this morning and you so desperately need a reviving. Let me remind you, it started when the Word of God was read and the people repented. Wouldn't it be something if you are the only thing standing in the way of revival? Wouldn't that be something? Wouldn't that be something? Father, thank you for the lesson we learned from Josiah. God, I pray that you would, God, please start at my heart. Start in my heart. God, convict me of the areas that I've been selfish. And then, Lord, I want, with all my heart, I want to be able to do more for you. So, God, I ask you once again to please, would you enable me and my family to give more, to do more? God, would you find us to be willing and cheerful at the opportunity that you give us? And then, Father, I pray that you would affect the same in every life, every heart here this morning. I thank you in Jesus' name with your heads.